So, Shruti ji, thank you very much for giving us your time. Maybe we can start with you telling us a little bit about the Bhatkhande Music Institute, how it was founded, who founded it, and what were the initial stages of this institute, what was the long-term vision?
Pandit Vishnu Narayan Bhatkhande ji started having music conferences, all India music conferences, from 1916. And the conference that he had in Lucknow in 1924 and 1925, everybody came to a decision that the Uttar Pradesh needs to have an institution where the people in the society are educated properly into music. They can be initiated into music in a very formal way. And many different ways, many different streams which are responsible for making Indian music what it is, they have to be understood and they have to be brought together. And so the music conferences resulted in a lot of brainstorming, and the product of it was the volumes of Hindustani Kramik Sangeet Paddhati, the volumes that Pandit Bhatkhande wrote. And he collected quite a lot of bandishes from the ustads and pandits that gathered together during these conferences. And the local talukdars of this place, they got very interested. They were feeling the lack of culture and cultural grooming for the society which other parts of India had. So they suggested that they would be willing to help to start an institution where the formal training in arts, performing arts, can be given to the children of the society. And not only that, they gave their properties like Rai Umanath Bali, Rai Rajeshwar Bali and Raja Nawab Ali, along with Pandit Bhatkhande, with his guidance, they formulated the idea of starting an institution. They gave the property to this institution. And not only that, they sent their own daughters, their family members, to this institution to get formally trained in music. And in 1926, the Marris College, because the governor was Mr. Marris, William Marris, so this institution was first called as Marris College of Music. It started in 1966. The Hindustani Sangeet Mahavidyalaya was undertaken by the government. Till 2000, it was under the government. And in 2000, this institution was declared as Bhatkhande Sangeet Sansthan, deemed to be university. Because this is a very unique university where only music, that is Gayan, Vadan and Nritya, vocal music, instrumental music and dance, is taught. No other subject is taught in this institution. And this is the specialty of this institution. Many stalwarts in the field of vocal music, in the field of instrumental music and dance have been associated with this institution, like Ustad Thirakwa Khasab, Pandit Ratanjan Karji. He himself was a student of Bhatkhande ji, and later on he became a student of Fayaz Khasab, Agra Gharana. And he was the biggest blessing that ever could have been given to this institution. He worked here as a principal, and he was very, very efficient person. He molded many, many students in the best possible way, where both the practical side and the theoretical side of the performing arts was taken care of very, very nicely and very authentically. And Pandit V.G. Jog, he worked here. Begum Akhtar ji, she also was here for some time as a guru in this institution. Ustad Sakhawat Hussain Khan Sahib, Sakharam ji, and many other people were associated with this institution. And this institution also produced quite a lot of masters in the field of music. After the institution was given the status of a university, we have started giving training in many different courses other than the traditional syllabus, like recording technique and music direction and conducting orchestra, chorus singing. All these courses have been started, and I am making special efforts to develop a studio where now I know that in Uttar Pradesh we are our government is promoting the Bollywood to come and make movies here. So I once spoke to the Honorable Chief Minister and I gave him my vision for the future of this institution, that it's not easy for every child to become a performing artist, and no institution can guarantee that every child will be a performing artist and a top-notch artist, because just as in a school you cannot guarantee that every child who enters your school or college can be Jayant Narlikar or can be Abdul Kalam ji. So we will create a very, very sensitive and critically evaluate karne ke kshamta rakhne wale, capable of evaluating, judging the musical renditions and all, such students we can develop, we can create from here, and we can show them many different ways as to how they can find a career in music, because music is becoming a big industry. And when the Bollywood comes here, they should take back a full film, fully processed film back from here, and they are not only given the venues for shooting, but they can also access for recording, editing, sound editing, film editing. All these courses have to be started, and from this institution our basic idea is to give traditional music education, but at the same time this traditional music has to have some channel open at one point of time, where you have to see that how to utilize the channel and how to utilize your knowledge of music, traditional music, for music direction, for creating other kind of music, because the basics are the same. Your awareness about the sur and tal, that is the basic material that you will have to have, and you have to realize that the base has to be, the foundation has to be very, very strong. And unless you have that, you can't be a good music director, you can't be a good editor also, sound editor also. This institution is an autonomous institution funded by the government. So the decisions of this institution are autonomous decisions based on the regulations that are provided to us by the UGC, and the government has to support us. They do support us. If there are certain things which they feel that at this point of the course in this institution's progress, it is not needed, or maybe the government is not able to fulfill this kind of a commitment, then it's very healthy relationship that I have with the government, because we always have the conferences, VC conferences, wherein we are allowed to put forth our problems, and we are also allowed to suggest what we want to do and what we envisage to do. And luckily for us, the government has been able to understand our needs. And in fact, very recently, about 2 years back, the Honorable Chief Minister also realized that this institution has a great potential, and he has offered to give us a second campus with a little bit more of space and infrastructure that will be needed, because the research in music, if we look at the situation, we find that in many conferences, papers are read either by the older musicians who are into music for the last at least 50, 60 years, or some students coming from foreign countries who look at music as a in a very different way, in a very scientific way, in a very methodical way. We are more attached to music in an emotional way, and for us it is more of a faith than a scientifically proven something that can be put down on paper and can be carried out as a scientific experiment. So I gave my vision to the Honorable Chief Minister, and he was very happy. I said, I want to find out new avenues to create new markets for music, because we have to create new market, we have to create new ways as to how to fulfill the needs, and we have to create needs first. Many different avenues can be tackled to create different musical needs for people, and for that our children will need to look at music in a very, very different way. We need to have multidisciplined and interdisciplined research. For that we need to collaborate with other universities where there is maths, physics and chemistry and science. They have these faculties. We need to collaborate with them. We need to have their lecturers come and give us some insight into the scientific approach to sound, scientific approach to phonetics. There are so many other things connected to music which have to be tackled, and we have never been concerned about it till now. No research work has ever dealt with these things. Instrument making, nobody is looking at it scientifically. There are families who have been making instruments, and slowly even those families are meeting the very, very tough competition with electronic instruments. So this is the time when we have to support them, support the artists who are making instruments. We have to support their ideas and their science. We have to find out. We can't just keep on saying the old scriptures, what they said was right. If it was right, why was it right? We have to prove it. So this scientific approach needs to be developed. And for that, I would like my institute to be to have a laboratory, to have a properly equipped studio where I can take my students and allow them to look into the scientific aspects which are connected with music. See, appointing the teachers, as far as that is concerned, we have the norms set out by the UGC. So the selection of teachers is as per the UGC norms. But students definitely need to have that feeling from inside that they have to do it in a very, very proper way. Unfortunately, what happens is most of the students turn to these courses because they do not get admissions. They do not have sufficient marks to take admissions for the science courses or commerce courses. This is a very, very big problem in the society today, that all the admissions in science courses and all, they stop at 95%, 90%. But what happens to the students who are between 40% and 80%, 40% and 60%. So for them, these courses for arts, they are open. And that does not mean that they are not intelligent. God has given everybody some special intelligence, and the intelligence can be utilized, and that has to be channelized. So I feel that from school itself, the children have to be educated. Because suddenly the children come here, because they don't have any admissions anywhere else, they come to the institution and they want to apply for the graduation course. Then we have to send them back to the diploma courses. First, let them equip themselves to be able to tackle the bachelor courses. Then only. Otherwise, they have some little education of music and then some master, bachelor degree in some other subject, and they want to appear for masters. It is not so easy, because music itself is a very, very thorough science. Today, if you want to be appointed as a lecturer, you have to do your PhD. Then there are NET exams, there are MPhil programs, and then you have to pass the tests also for PhDs and all that. So once you have that, then you are supposed to be qualified. One grievance I have is that I have been to many universities as a member of the selection committee. Unfortunately, you have the NET certificate, you have the PhD certificate in your hands, and you are unable to even tune your own instrument, your tanpura, your tabla. And this is a very pathetic situation. If the teacher himself is unable to tune the tanpura, what kind of music is he going to hand out to the students?
What is the reason for this lacuna?
Basically, nobody wants to put in hard work. Although I believe tuning a tanpura or tuning a tabla is not such a hard work which cannot be achieved in one lifetime or in 2 months or 3 months. It is not something that is impossible. One has to just put one's mind to it. The electronic tanpura is a convenience. The electronic tabla is a convenience. Now they also have added the numbers of matras that you are covered, so that you don't even have to bother to listen to the tabla bowls. So how much are we going to make it simplified for the students? In the effort to make music simple for the people, we are losing out on the quality. Some hard work, I refuse to call it hard work, but it is termed as hard work. They have to put in, the teachers also have to put in. I have been to some institutions where I asked the students, why didn't you tune the tanpura before I came to the class? No, the head of the department has said, don't touch the tanpura, if you break the strings, who is going to tune them? Who is going to put on the new strings? Because she herself doesn't know how to do it. We have about 107 created posts and 1800 students on our register, which is a very big number, because our students are not only local students, they come from different countries. They come through ICC and some of them they come on their own. We have students from Sri Lanka, Nepal, Afghanistan, Japan, France, Russia.
And they stay here?
Yes, we have our hostels. Some prefer to stay outside, but we have a girls' hostel, we have a boys' hostel here. And luckily, you see, the institute has had masters invited here to work as gurus because of their expertise in this subject. After the proper administration started taking over, after the rules and regulations were formulated, then we had to go for a certain criteria set up for the selection of teachers. They came from all stratas of the society, those who were educated, those who had degrees in music, some of the, them were past students of the institution itself. Some of the teachers had their students, very talented students, so they were appointed. So today, definitely in the last 15 years, ever since it became a university, the selection has been through as per the criteria of the UGC.
So in a way, it's a strength and a weakness, because if you would like to appoint well-known performers in the field of Hindustani music, you may not be able to do that.
You can't do it. We can have them as experts coming here. We can request them to stay here as guest lecturers, and we can pay them separately. But there also are restrictions as to how much maximum we can pay them.
Right.
So, if the performing artist is a busy artist, he is good at performance, and he is too good at performance, then that's why we have karyashalas, we have workshops limited to 8 days, 10 days, which can be a relaxation for them, a change for them, and they can also be with the students and share their experiences.
And this has also impacted the student body composition, right?
Yes.
Because earlier you had students who were wanting to become performers.
Yes.
And now you have
so many of
students.
Them, especially girls, if they have to be married, they have to have some degree certificate in their hands. Funnily, once I was not very happy with the thesis of a girl, so I said I feel she should take some more time and do some more research, and she can add it to her thesis. No, madam, chhod dijiyega, let it be. The reason was given, she should have the PhD so that she doesn't have to give this much of dowry. There is a concession in dowry. A very unfortunate situation. Very unfortunate situation. So, it was a shock for me. But then this is what it is. And many times, the reality shows, they inspire the children to take up the performing arts. Of course, some of them, they get interested more for the sake of music and not for the competitions and winning the prizes and all that. But then that happens a little later. They have to spend at least 2 years at the institution. Then they realize what is the strength, actual strength of music, and the knowledge of music. We have formulated our syllabus as per the syllabus of all the universities which have music departments. Because so many of the universities have music as a department, and this is the only university of music. So we have taken help of them, and then by and by the UGC releases different sets of norms. Then there are PhD rules, how the PhDs can be conducted, how the examiners can be appointed, how the experts can be appointed. All these things they send us, and then as per that we follow the norms of the UGC. And that is why whatever we do, because you know that in this country people are very 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 eager to go to the court at every small thing, and we have to face those challenges, and for that we make it sure that whatever steps we take, they are very, very foolproof. In the other universities, music as a department, there is no direct responsibility of the head of the department. He does not take any decisions. Here, I take the decisions. My decisions are all mine, the responsibility is all mine, and the degrees that we hand out here, they are recognized everywhere else. And the activities are totally centered. That is a full-time activity. It is not a departmental activity. Departmental activity is a very different kind of activity. We have department, vocal department, dance department and instrument department. But that again comes under the university section. University section. And then it is a holistic approach for everything. Our cultural programs, they are not only singled out for this is only the music department. We have our students, some of the students participate in the dance programs with their own faculty. Some other students participate in the instrument department. We have interdisciplinary, interdepartmental exchange of students. Some of the dance classes are accompanied by students because we gave them the chance to accompany the dance also. They should go to the vocal classes also to accompany the vocal music also. So this is much easier for us. It's not only a vocal department. In many universities, there is no tabla department, there is no instrument department, string instrument department. We have many instruments here. We have guitar, we have sitar, flute, harmonium, sarangi, violin.
Sarangi also.
Yes, yes, violin. So these are different vidha. But the students, they participate in activities with all others. So their whole idea changes, you know. It is not only I am doing the riyaz of the saregama padane satane dabarga on my flute and I have to play the flute. My flute has to be also used for a dance performance. My flute also has to be used for a vocal performance. And then how do I use my technique? Playing technique also changes according to the accompaniment. There they have to think about it. And then we instruct them. See, you are a tabla player, you are going to play a solo. But now you have to play with dance. So your knowledge of your solo, how will you convert it into a sangat for kathak, a sangat for violin performance, how a sangat for vocal performance. So these are the experiences that our students get on a very regular basis. See, this institution is a very old institution, and practically every house has a chachi, mami, an aunt, a bahu, a father-in-law, a mother-in-law who has had some training in music from this institution. Every house has it, practically every house. People come from abroad, they come to see the institution. So many people come here just to touch the steps and offer their respects to the institution. So this institution has a lot of respect in the minds of the people. It is respected, very highly respected. And the people of Lucknow, they take it as a pride. But the only thing that has hurt me is that in the heritage walk, they do not include this institution. They include the Baradari, they include the Hazrat Mahal Park, but they, I don't know how, where they hide this Bhatkhande when they go for a heritage walk. It's very painful because this institution has given a different identity to this place, this Uttar Pradesh. Just as you have one Taj Mahal, you have one university which is totally dedicated to music. You should be proud of it. But then the people in this city, they have a lot of respect for this institution. Yes, it's been a great change in my life. I had never aspired to be behind in a table and signing the files, never. But somehow I got into it. I was invited to take up this post. It was not a job. I was told, "Madam, this is not a job. It's a post of honor. So the first thing is that I'm not doing a job. And for me, this place is a holy place for every musician. The seat where most respected people like Pandit Ratanjankar ji had been here in this seat, and they shaped up this institute. In fact, this institute got the name because of the basic groundwork of these people. So I realized that this is a great responsibility, and I'm a trustee of this institute. And I have to do whatever best I can do for the institute. Learning in the Guru Shishya Parampara had its wonderful moments and benefits for me. I realized that so many things I learned, just as I learned to speak, it was music with my daily activity, along with my other activities, it was music with me. So singing was nothing special that I was doing. It was never a special thing. I was called up while I was playing with my friends. Some Ustadji or some Panditji would come to visit my father, and he would say, "Dara beta, Basanti Kannada gao." I would sit down, he would play the tabla. I would sit down, I would sing. "Ab main khelne jao?" And I would go down. I never realized ki what I was doing and what kind of music I was singing, because it was very natural for me. So music was very natural for me as far as my Guru Shishya Parampara system goes. But I was made to join masters from the SNTT University by my mother. She said, "Only being a musician is not sufficient. You should have the theoretical knowledge, and you should be able to support what you say. You should be able to convince what you sing. You have to convince the people. Is granth mein ye kaha gaya hai, isme ye kaha gaya hai, iske aadhar par main ye kar rahe hain. You have to give them the proof. And if at all you are doing something and you are not convinced, you will find the answers there. And if you don't have the answers, you'll have a ground, you'll have a foundation from where you can start and find your own answers." That was a very good approach that I think she showed me. And that's why I took up the master's course. And I was very happy because it gave me a different kind of an insight into music. Even then, after that, I never joined any service. I didn't become a professor of music, I didn't become a professor of languages. But suddenly this position was offered to me. And I took it up as a service to this institution, because some things had gone wrong with the institution. And I'm basically a very discipline-loving person. So, and it has never been difficult for me to be disciplined. So when I took up the charge, I tried to put things in order. I tried to see, and I did see, that people do things properly in order. The classes run properly. The students attend. The attendance of the students is not affected. The attendance of the teachers is not affected. And personally, I visit the classes. I take a round and I visit the classes. If I find that the teachers are having some problem in teaching certain things, I call them to my office. I inspect the classes, I call them to my office, I tell them how to do it. I go to the dance classes also, I go to the tabla classes also. Whatever little I get to learn from there, I learn it. And if I have questions, I ask them. In a way, it opens up many channels for the students also, because sometimes they feel that they cannot ask the questions to the teachers. So some of the students students are very shy. Some problems are very basic problems, and they are attending the master's classes, and they feel that this is such a simple problem, how can I ask, because I am doing the master's. But then unless the basic problem is solved, you cannot study anything further. So I know sometimes, now that I've been in this institution for over about 7 years now, I get the feeling what the children are thinking about, and I ask the questions. We have brought a very good system and very good method in the evaluation of the PhD thesis also, and I have tried to put things in proper shape. Not every student can take it for granted that the moment the thesis is presented, his PhD is guaranteed. We are very strict with that also, because we have to make sure that the standard of the thesis is up to the mark. Because unfortunately, I don't see students from any music departments or teachers participating in international music conferences or reading papers, which is very unfortunate, because the standard of research has to improve, and for that I'm taking precautions and I'm very strict about it. And we have very highly educated people, very highly qualified people on our boards also. Our academic council also has very good teachers, very good professors, and experts from outside who keep us on track.